Red Brick Media. High quality CDs, DVDs, lectures, khutbah, conferences and Quran recitations. All revenue generated supports our dawah work, supported by visiting our store. You can now purchase directly from our site, www.redbrickmedia.co.uk. غرباء غرباء
غرباء غرباء. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، إله الأولين والآخرين، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله المبعوث رحمة للعالمين، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه وأنصاره إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فكما علمتم أيها الإخوة، إن موضوع هذه المحاضرة عن الإمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى. ولا شك أن هذا الإمام جدير بأن تذكر سيرته الطيبة ويذكر بأثره العظيم في الأمة في مثل هذا المؤتمر الذي يعنى بذكر أهل الحديث وبيان مآثر علمائهم وأثرهم في الأمة.
After praising Allah, I praise Allah, I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship but Allah, the guardian of the first and the last. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his slave and messenger and a mercy to all mankind, for the first and the last. Amma ba'd, as to proceed, the Sheikh says, as you know, this topic is the topic of Imam al-Bukhari. May Allah have mercy on him. And no doubt it's full of merit that such an Imam should be mentioned and discussed in this conference, and his qualities and his good seerah. In such a conference where the ulama and scholars of the people of Hadith are being mentioned, their efforts, their effects and influences on the Ummah.
ولا شك أن هذا الموضوع واسع وكبير، ولكن سنحاول أن نختصر ونراعي الوقت، فربما يعني تكون هناك بعض المعلومات أتجاوزها في هذه المحاضرة، ونركز على بعض المعاني التي أراها مفيدة بالنسبة لنا جميعا، بالنسبة للمسلم الذي يريد أن يتعرف على هذا الإمام، وكذلك أيضا أن يأخذ بقبس من أدبه وفضله وآثاره الطيبة.
And undoubtedly this topic is vast, so I'll try to summarize because time is short. So I'll skip a few issues of lesser importance and stress other issues which have greater benefit, especially for those Muslims who want to know this Imam and know his effects.
وأحب أن أبدأ المحاضرة بأول ما بدأ به واستفتح به الإمام البخاري صحيحه، فقال: حدثنا الحميدي عبد الله بن الزبير، قال حدثنا سفيان بن عيينة، قال حدثنا يحيى بن سعيد الأنصاري، قال أخبرني محمد بن إبراهيم التيمي أنه سمع علقمة بن وقاص الليثي يقول: سمعت عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه على المنبر قال: سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: يا أيها الناس، إنما الأعمال بالنيات، وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى، فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله، ومن كانت هجرته إلى لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه.
And I'd like to begin my talk with what Imam al-Bukhari began his book with. He said, Al-Humaydi narrated to me, that Sufyan ibn Uyayna narrated to me, on the authority of Yahya ibn Sa'id, on the authority of Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Taymi, on the authority of Al-Qama, on the authority of Umar, who was on the minbar. Al-Qama said, I heard Umar on the minbar say, O mankind, actions are merely based on their intentions, and every person shall have what they intended. So whoever's migration was for Allah and his messenger, then his migration would be for Allah and his messenger. But whoever's migration is for the dunya, the world, or merely to marry a woman, then that is what his migration shall be for.
فَبِالنِّيَّةِ الصَّالِحَةِ وَبِالْإِخْلَاصِ لِلَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى وَبِحُسْنِ الْقَصْدِ يَكُونُ رَفْعُ الذِّكْرِ وَيَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لِلْمَرْءِ طَيِّبَ الْأَثَرِ ويجعله أهلا للعلم والفقه. ولا شك أن الإمام البخاري عندما استفتح صحيحه بهذا الحديث العظيم إنما كان يعبر عما في نفسه من القصد إلى التعبد لله سبحانه وتعالى بهذا العمل وهو وضع الصحيح، فكان في ذلك توجيها وتوبية وموعظة لنفسه خاصة ولكل من يقرأ كتابه ويقف على أثره.
And because of this hadith, it is with righteous intention, with purity of heart and sincerity and good motives that Allah raises people's status so that they can be good influences in this world and that they can be people who are worthy of knowledge and worthy of deep understanding. And it's as if Imam al-Bukhari, when he began this book, he was describing what was in his heart, that it is with his heart motivated towards Allah and intention before every action that he proceeds and begins this great book, as if it's a sermon for himself and a sermon and a preaching for those who read the book after him.
فالإمام البخاري نموذج صالح ومثال طيب لأحد أئمة الحديث من الذين رفع الله تعالى ذكرهم وأعلى شأنهم بالعلم والإخلاص والنية والعمل ومتابعة السنة حتى صار هذا الإمام يذكر في كل مناسبة للمسلمين ذكروا فيه حديث نبيهم صلى الله عليه وسلم. و لتفكروا معي اليوم عندما صلينا الجمعة كم من خطيب في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها ذكر حديثا وعزاه لهذا الإمام فجدد ذكره على منبر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، فهكذا خلد ذكر هذا الإمام كما حفظ الله سبحانه وتعالى كما حفظ سنته صلى الله عليه وسلم، فصار ذكره مع ذكر سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهذا شرف عظيم ومنزلة جليلة لا تنال إلا بالإخلاص والتجرد لله سبحانه وتعالى.
And what a righteous role model Imam Bukhari is of the Imams of Ahl al-Hadith. His reputation was raised for knowledge, for sincerity, for good action and following Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to the extent that he's mentioned in all occasions where a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioned. Just think about today when we pray Jumu'ah, how throughout the world, east and west, when imams quote a hadith, they'll be mentioning his name. His name is renewed. His name has been made eternal as he preserved the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. As he raised the status of the sunnah, so did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise his status and his name, and this is because of his sincerity and purity of heart.
وقبل أن نبدأ بمحاولة أخذ بعض الدروس والعبر من سيرة هذا الإمام، لا بد أن نشير إشارة مختصرة موجزة إلى التعريف به من جهة ذكر اسمه ومولده. فهو الإمام أبو عبد الله محمد بن إسماعيل بن إبراهيم بن المغيرة بن بردزبة الجعفي البخاري، وكان أول من أسلم من آبائه أبو جده المغيرة أسلم على يد يمان الجعفي الذي كان واليا على مدينة بخارى.
So before we begin this lecture in full, I'd like to just point out his lineage, the lineage, and a brief explanation of who he is. He is Imam Abu Abdullah Muhammad, the son of Ismail, the son of Ibrahim, the son of Mughira al-Bardizba al-Ju'fi al-Bukhari. It was his great-grandfather, al-Mughira, who became a Muslim at the hands of Aman al-Ju'fi?
Yaman.
Yaman al-Ju'fi, who was the governor of Medina at that time.
إذن أصل البخاري من الفوز وكان أجداده قبل إسلام جده الأعلى المغيرة كانوا على دين المجوس عباد النار.
So his origin was that he was a Persian. His great grandfather Mughira therefore was originally a Zoroastrian worshippers of fire.
فالبخاري لم يكن من العرب ولكنه نسب إلى العرب أعني نسبته إلى الجعفي لأن المغيرة أسلم على يد ذلك الوالي العربي يمان الجعفي فنسب البخاري إلى قبيلته من باب الولاء والنصرة كما كان الأمر على ذلك في ذلك الوقت ولم تكن هذه النسبة من باب النسب الحقيقي.
So because his great-grandfather became a Muslim through the hands of Yaman al-Ju'fi, he took the lineage of Yaman al-Ju'fi as it was the tradition at that time that if a person did enter into Islam through certain other people, then they would take the lineage of the people who they entered into Islam through. So in origin, he was a Persian and not an Arab.
إن دل هذا على شيء فإنما يدل على أن المجتمع الإسلامي في ذاك الوقت لم يكن يعرف الفوارق العرقية والجنسية والعنصرية فهؤلاء الذين أسلموا ودخلوا في المجتمع الإسلامي لم يشعروا أبدا بشيء من التمييز أو التفرقة بل إنهم وجدوا في العرب الفاتحين وجدوا من حسن الخلق وحسن المعاملة ما جعلهم يتشجعون ويتسابقون في تعلم اللغة العربية وخدمة هذا الدين العظيم.
So if this shows anything, it shows that society in those times didn't differentiate between people's racial differences and origins. Those who entered into Islam, they were treated as equals, they were treated as from the tribes of Islam. And as the conquerors or the people who conquered the lands of Islam went to different countries, through their dealings, through their behavior, people were inspired and also they were inspired to learn the Arabic language.
وكيف لا يكون ذلك وأولئك الفاتحون وأولادهم وأتباعهم كانوا من ثمار تربية النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وجهده وعمله ودعوته أعني الصحابة الكرام رضوان الله تعالى عليهم الذين خرجوا من الجزيرة العربية يحملهم على ذلك إرادة إيصال الخير إلى الناس وإخراجهم من الظلمات إلى النور ومن جور الأديان إلى عدل الإسلام ومن ضيق الدنيا إلى سعة الدنيا والآخرة حتى شهد بحسن أخلاقهم وبعدل سيرتهم شهد بذلك كل منصف حتى من الأعداء كما قال المستشرق الشهير جوستاف ليون قال لم يعرف التاريخ فاتحا أرحم من العرب.
And that's not surprising because these people who conquered and opened up the lands were the children and descendants of those very people, the companions who Rasulullah himself raised and nourished with knowledge. They are the ones who originally left the Arabian Peninsula to extend the goodness of Islam to the world, to take people from darkness into light, from oppression of jahiliyyah and ignorance to the justice and fairness of Islam, from darkness and the constraint tightness of the world to the vastness of the world and the hereafter. And this is something which is witnessed, bear testimony to by Muslims and non-Muslims, as the Orientalist Gustave Lyon, he says that history hasn't known of conquerors more merciful than the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
فالبخاري رحمه الله ولد ومات في بلاد نائية عن المركز الإسلامي فتحها الصحابة وأولاد الصحابة بجهادهم ودمائهم وكان ذلك في زمن خير ملوك الإسلام الصحابي الجليل معاوية بن أبي سفيان رضي الله تعالى عنه وهناك ولد الإمام البخاري ولد في مدينة بخارى وهي تقع حالياً في جمهورية أوزبكستان ومات أيضا في منطقة قريبة من مولده في قرية خرتنك بالقرب من سمرقند وهي أيضا داخلة حاليا في حدود جمهورية أوزبكستان.
And Bukhari himself, he was born in those regions, the regions of Bukhara, a place which was conquered in the reign of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, and that is Bukhara, a place which exists today in the Republic of Uzbekistan, and that is where, not far from there, where he died near Samarkand, also today in the Republic of Uzbekistan.
كان مولد الإمام البخاري رحمه الله سنة 94 و100 سنة 94 و100 للهجرة الشريفة. وبالتاريخ الميلادي سنة 810 ووفاته رحمه الله سنة 56 و200 وبالتاريخ الميلادي 870 سنة 870.
He was born in the year 194 in the Hijri calendar, which is equivalent to about 810 in the Christian calendar, in the Gregorian calendar. He died in the year 256 of the Hijri calendar, and the year, which is the year 870 of the Gregorian calendar.
هذه نبذة مختصرة ثم ندخل إلى ما هو المقصود الأعظم من هذه المحاضرة. طبعا هذه التفاصيل التاريخية تجدونها في الكتب وهي كثيرة في هذا الباب.
So let's now enter into the main topic, and these details of history can be found in their relevant books.
ما هي العوامل التي أثرت في تكوين هذه الشخصية الفذة؟ لا شك أن أول العوامل وأهمها وقبل كل شيء توفيق الله سبحانه وتعالى وتهيئته هذا الإنسان ليكون من خدمة دينه وسنة نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم. فالله سبحانه وتعالى يسخر من عباده ما يجعلهم سببا لحفظ هذا الدين، وهذا من دلائل صدق النبوة ومن علائم أن هذا الدين محفوظ من عند من بعث به محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم. ولهذا قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن الله يغرس في هذا الدين غرسا يستعملهم في طاعته. إن الله يغرس في هذا الدين غرسا يستعملهم في طاعته. أخرجه ابن ماجه وهو حديث حسن.
So what are the main factors that make this character such a unique person? Undoubtedly, before everything, the first and most important thing is the tawfiq and the facilitation given by Allah. The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared him to be this servant of the deen and the preserver of sunnah. When Allah wants, he makes it easy for a slave of his to choose him for the path of the preservation of deen. And this is one of the signs of prophethood, because he had spoken the truth that he would, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send people who would revive this deen. As in the hadith, which is in Ibn Majah, and it's a Hassan hadith, Allah raises raises people up a growth for this deen, he will use for his obedience. Allah raises up people who will grow up for this deen, and he will grow them up or raise them up to use them for his obedience.
فالله سبحانه وتعالى هيأ هذا الرجل منذ الصغر لأن يكون حافظا لحديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقذف ذلك في قلبه حتى أن الإمام البخاري نفسه كان يقول ألهمت حفظ الحديث وأنا في الكتاب. الكتاب يعني في عرفنا المدرسة الابتدائية أو حتى يعني ربما قبل الابتدائية أو هذه الفترة. قال قد أتى علي 10 سنين أو أقل، قد أتى علي 10 سنين أو أقل فألهم العناية بحفظ حديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو لا يعلم ولا يدرك لأي أمر هيأه الله سبحانه وتعالى.
So Allah Ta'ala prepares a person's life and prepared his life to be a hafiz and a preserver of the deen. And he placed in his heart at an early age memorization of hadith. As Imam al-Bukhari himself said, I was inspired to memorize hadith well while I was merely in the kutab. Kutab are like the children's madrasas we still have at the age of primary school. He also said, I wasn't even 10 years old or perhaps less when I was inspired to memorize. And perhaps he didn't even know what he was memorizing so much and so easily for.
نعم، ولكن هذا لا يمنع أيضا أن ننظر في الأسباب الكونية والشرعية في تكوين هذه الشخصية لنأخذ من ذلك الدروس والعبر، وإن كان جميع ذلك من توفيق الله تعالى وفضله.
But that doesn't stop us then still from looking at worldly causes and worldly reasons from which we can take lesson and example, even though all these examples are an extension of Allah's tawfiq, the first cause.
فمن أهم الأسباب شدة ذكائه وقوة حفظه وحدة ذهنه وقوة نفسه وقدرتها على الصبر والتحمل، وهناك أمثلة كثيرة على ذلك.
And the first of these is his immense intellect and his power of memory, his sharp mind, his strong character and his ability to undertake hardships.
من ذلك أنه كان يقول كتبت عن 1000 شيخ أو أكثر عن كل واحد منهم 10,000 حديث وأكثر ما عندي حديث إلا وأذكر إسناده.
Of these examples of his intellect and memory, etc., he says, I have written hadith from 1,000 different sheikhs, and from each one, 10,000 hadith. But for each hadith I memorized, I haven't forgotten a single chain of narrations, isnad.
وكان يذهب مع أصحابه إلى المشايخ لسماع الحديث، فكانوا هم يكتبون وهو لا يكتب. فعابوا عليه ذلك وانتقدوه، فقال لهم أعرضوا علي ما تكتبون، فعرضوا عليه ما كتبوه خلال هذه المدة عند الحضور عند مشايخهم، فسرد ذلك كله من حفظه ولم يخرم حديثا، وكان ذلك أكثر من 15,000 حديث.
Sometimes he would go with his friends to a sheikh, and they would all write down the hadith they were listening to from the teacher. And he himself wouldn't write a single thing down. So they told him off about that. He told them to read their hadith to him from their books, and they did. Then he narrated all the hadith which he had in his memory back to them without making a single mistake. And there were 15,000 in number.
ولعلكم سمعتم بتلك القصة المشهورة، وهي الحقيقة قصة ثابتة رووها يعني بالإسناد. وذلك لما دخل الإمام البخاري إلى بغداد، فسمع المحدثون بما يذكر من شدة حفظه، فأرادوا أن يمتحنوه. فعمدوا إلى 100 حديث فقلبوا متونها وأسانيدها، يعني جعلوا إسناد هذا الحديث لهذا المتن ومتن هذا الحديث لهذا الإسناد، فقلبوها ووزعوها إلى 10 أنفس، ثم جعلوا هناك مجلسا كبيرا جامعا لأهل الحديث، فعرض كل واحد من هؤلاء 10 أحاديثه 10 المقلوبة على الإمام البخاري، فكان كلما سمع بحديث من هذه الأحاديث يقول لا أعرفه، ثم يذكر الحديث الآخر فيقول لا أعرفه، ثم يذكر إلى أن أتموا ذكر هذه الأحاديث 100.
And of the story, which is actually a true story, which is mentioned with its chain of narrators, that when he entered Baghdad, the muhaddithun, scholars of hadith in Baghdad, had heard so much about his memory, and they wanted to put him to test. They took 100 hadith and decided to mix the texts, the wordings of the hadith, with the chains of narrators and the chains of narrators. So each chain would have a different text with it. They then distributed these hadith amongst 10 different people. And they had a gathering, a meeting with Imam al-Bukhari. Each of them, one by one, would mention their hadith. So when they did mention their hadith, one by one, with the text with the wrong chain, he would say each time, I don't recognize this hadith, I don't know this hadith.
فلما انتهوا جميعا عند ذلك التفت للأول فقال له حديثك الأول كذا وصوابه كذا وحديثك الثاني كذا وصوابه كذا، ثم قال للثاني كذلك حتى أتم ذكر تلك الأحاديث 100 على نفس التسلسل ولكن بالوجه الصحيح الثابت.
After they had completed their narrations, he turned to the first person and said, as for the hadith you mentioned, it should have this other chain. And he corrected his 10 hadith. Then he turned to the next person and said, as for your 10 hadith, this text should have this chain, and this text, other text should have another chain. And he mentioned them all. He repeated all the hadith in the order that they were given to, in which they were given to him, but with the correct chains until he completed all the 100 hadith.
حتى قال الحافظ العراقي رحمه الله تعالى قال حفظه لهذه الأحاديث المقلوبة في ذاك المجلس وبذاك التسلسل ثم تصحيحه لها أعجب من كونه كان يحفظ تلك الأحاديث من قبل، يعني الأحاديث الصحيحة.
Regarding which Imam al-Iraqi said his memorizing, his correction of these hadith, putting the correct chains to the correct texts in the correct order as well in how they were mentioned to him, is actually more astonishing than the fact that he had memorized them in the first place.
إذن كان الإمام شديد الذكاء قوي الحافظة حاد الذهن، ولكن هذه صفات خلقية الله سبحانه وتعالى يخلق بعض الناس عليها، يمنحها الله سبحانه وتعالى لمن يشاء من عباده، والإنسان لا يمدح لأنه ذكي وله قدرة على الحفظ وعنده قوة وقدرة، لا يمدح على هذا لأن هذا شيء لم يحصله بكسبه وكده. كذلك الإنسان لا يجوز أن نذمه على قلة ذكائه وضعف حفظه وقدرته، لأن هذا أيضا من عند الله سبحانه وتعالى قد يحرم بعض الناس من هذه الصفات.
But these characteristics, his severe memory, his sharp intellect, they're physical characteristics which are gifts from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. So a person shouldn't be praised for his intellect and his sharp memory because they are things which he didn't have to work for and struggle for to develop. At the same time, a person with a lesser intellect, with weak memory, shouldn't be condemned because they too have been given that disposition by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
ولكن من أعطي هذه الصفات يمدح إذا استعملها فيما فيه مرضاة الله سبحانه وتعالى وسخرها لخدمة الحق والخير. وكذلك من عنده نقص في هذه الصفات يذم إذا احتج بها على تضييع حقوق الله تعالى أو حقوق العباد.
But at the same time, if a person uses this great intellect and sharp memory to please Allah, to serve the truth and goodness, then they can be praised for doing that. At the same time, a person who's deficient in their intellect and memory, if they allow that to be a reason by which they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they can be condemned for misusing that.
البخاري يمدح لأنه استعمل ما منحه الله سبحانه وتعالى من المواهب التي ذكرناها في الخير وفي خدمة حديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. لهذا ننتقل إلى المجموعة الثانية من الأسباب، وهي الأسباب الشرعية التي استعملها البخاري رحمه الله وأخذ بها وبذل في ذلك جهدا وكان منه إرادة وعزيمة وصدق.
So Bukhari can be praised and is praised because he did indeed use his great qualities of memory and intellect to serve the truth and to serve the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is why we move on now to the second reason, the causes which are in the Sharia which he used by which he applied effort and truth and sincerity.
نعم وأول ذلك إخلاصه وصدق نيته وحسن مقصده وقد أشرت إلى هذا وأذكر هنا قوله رحمه الله ما وضعت في كتابي الصحيح حديثا إلا اختسلت قبل ذلك وصليت ركعتين وتيقنت صحته. هذا يدل على احتسابه ونيته الصالحة.
Of these first reasons it is his severity in sincerity and good intentions which we have mentioned. One of his statements which tell us of this is, he said, I haven't placed a single hadith in this book except that I bathed beforehand, then I prayed two rak'ahs, and I only placed the hadith in the book when I was completely certain of its authenticity after that.
هذا الإخلاص والنية للإمام البخاري والحقيقة شواهد كثيرة وأنا أريد أن أختصر اقترن بها العمل اقترن بها العمل وهذه صفة أخرى من صفات هذا الإمام وهو كثرة العبادة وكثرة الأعمال الصالحة والزهد في الدنيا والإقبال على الله سبحانه وتعالى.
But also this sincerity was coupled with something else, his action. He was a person of ample worship or a person who had an immense amount of righteous actions. A person who would flee and belittle the dunya, and a person who would work and go towards Allah, proceed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that.
فكان الإمام البخاري كثير التلاوة لكتاب الله تعالى يذكر عنه وصح ذلك أنه كان يختم القرآن الكريم في رمضان في كل ثلاث ليال. وكان إذا صلى ملكت الصلاة عليه نفسه وروحه وأقبل عليها بكليته حتى أنه ذات يوم كان يصلي لسعه الزنبور فلما قضى صلاته قال انظروا إلى هذا الذي آذاني في صلاته فنظروا فإذا الزنبور قد لسعه في 17 موضعا ومع ذلك لم يقطع صلاته ولم ينصرف من صلاته.
One of the examples of his continuity and the ample worship he did was his tilawa of the Quran. It's been mentioned that he used to finish the Quran every 3 nights in Ramadan. Furthermore, he was known for his worship and prayer and to pray with his heart and soul and concentration. that once he was praying and he was stung by a wasp. He continued to pray. And at the end of the prayer, he looked round and said, and he noticed the wasp and said, "Look at this creature that's trying to harm me and distract me in my prayer." It was later discovered that he had been stung in 17 different places.
SubhanAllah. وكان لا يفوت فرصة إقامة عبادة أو عمل صالح فلما كان في البصرة وأقام فيها 5 سنين وجد نفسه قريبا من الديار المقدسة فكان يحج من البصرة كل سنة ويرجع من الحج إلى البصرة ليتم ما كان منصرفا إليه هناك من سماع الحديث وتدوينه وتصنيف كتبه.
Also when he would take every opportunity to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when he moved to Basra for 5 years, because he was now closer to the lands of Mecca and Medina, every year from then on he used to go and perform the Hajj. He'd come back from the Hajj and then complete the listening of hadith, the compilation of hadith, and the collecting of hadith which he had to discontinue because of the Hajj.
وكان قد جمع همه وهمته على أمر الآخرة وتفرغ للعلم وزهد في الدنيا زهدا عظيما مع الورع والتحري. كان يقول: ما توليت شراء شيء قط، كنت آمر إنسانا فيشتري لي. قيل له: لماذا لا تذهب إلى السوق وتشتري بنفسك؟ قال: لما فيه من الزيادة والنقصان والتخليط، أي من باب الورع وتجنب الشبهات. كان يتجنب الخوض في مثل أمور الدنيا التي يمكن أن تدخل عليه شبهة أو تشغل باله وتشتت فكرة.
Of his renunciation of the dunya, of his wanting to be free for the acts of knowledge and his renouncement of the dunya, is that he never asked anyone to go to the market on his behalf. And they were asked him why. Why did he never ask anyone to go to the market on his behalf? And that the reason was that he didn't want to have an interaction with people. He didn't want to have any... He said, I always asked somebody else if they could go to the market for me. And the reason was because if someone else went to the market on his behalf, then that person would be the person who's negotiating, and person who would be, and he was a person who didn't want to go and fall into arguments. He didn't want, for the sake of the dunya, to raise prices, to lower prices, and to mix up intentions.
إذن هكذا كان إخلاص الإمام البخاري وصدق نيته، وهكذا كانت عبادته وزهده وورعه.
And that was the sincerity of Imam Bukhari. Such was his scrupulousness, such was his sincerity and his distance from the dunya.
هذان الأمران إذا اجتمعا ماذا يثمران وينتجان؟ الإيمان والإخلاص وصدق النية مع العبادة والزهد والورع وحسن العمل، ماذا ينتج هذان الأمران؟
And these two factors, what are their fruits? What is the product of these two factors? The fact that he had iman and sincerity and honesty in his heart to Allah, coupled with ibadah and worship and good actions and sincerity, good actions and distance from the dunya.
إنهما ينتجان ويثمران الأخلاق الصالحة وحسن السيرة. نعم أيها الإخوة والأخوات، الأخلاق الفاضلة شرط في العالم الرباني، كما أنه ثمرة لإخلاصه وعلمه وديانته وصدقه مع الله سبحانه وتعالى.
What they give rise to and the fruits they produce are akhlaq and morals and behavior which are elevated and noble, and a conduct which is praiseworthy. Indeed, to have this conduct and this behavior is a condition, a prerequisite of someone who is a scholar who raises other people upon scholarly knowledge, as it is a condition for Allah's pleasure for a person who is trying to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and please him.
لهذا كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خير الناس في أخلاقه وأدابه لأنه الأسوة والقدوة في ذلك. وقد أخبر صلى الله عليه وسلم أن الدعوة إلى الأخلاق الصالحة الزكية أصل من أصول دعوته وبعثته، فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنما بعثت لأتمم صالح الأخلاق. أخرجه البخاري في الأدب المفرد.
Which is why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the best person is the one who is best in his akhlaq and his adab, his morals, manners and conduct, because the person is leading by his conduct. And he also mentioned that calling and doing da'wah to good akhlaq and through good akhlaq and morals and manners is actually a pillar and principle of deen, by saying his statement, indeed I've been sent merely to rectify good manners, recorded by Al-Bukhari in Adab Al-Mufrad.
والعلماء هم ورثة الأنبياء، فهم أحق الناس والأوجب عليهم أن يتخلقوا بأخلاقه صلى الله عليه وسلم، فيكون ورثته في العلم والعمل والسلوك والأخلاق. فلا تظنوا إخوتي في الله، لا تظنوا أن العالم يكون عالماً ربانياً مقبولاً عند الأمة قبولاً عاماً وهو سيء الأخلاق، ضيق العطن، خبيث النفس، يشتكي الناس من غلظته وفظاظته وسوء خلقه.
And therefore the scholars amongst people, the scholars are the inheritors of prophets, and therefore it is more obligatory and more necessary for scholars to adopt the characteristics of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so they are following him in his manners, in his knowledge and his action and his morals and manners. Which is why a scholar who raises other people on knowledge will not be accepted by the ummah as a great scholar who raises people on the book and the sunnah if that person has bad manners, if they are rude, if they lack morals or they lack etiquette with other people.
ظهر على البخاري رحمه الله أثر العلم والعبادة ومجاهدة النفس، فكان كريم الأخلاق، طيب النفس، لين الجانب، لطيف العبارة، كان رحمه الله شديد الحياء، وكما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: الحياء خير كله، والحياء من الإيمان. حتى أنه لما دخل على شيخه محمد بن سلام وتحدث معه وجالسه ثم خرج، فقال هذا الإمام محمد بن سلام رحمه الله لمن حضر من جلسائه: أترون البكر أشد حياء من هذا؟ أترون البكر أشد حياء من هذا؟ ويعني بذلك الإمام البخاري رحمه الله.
And his knowledge appeared on in his behavior fully. It was manifest. He was a person who was extremely soft, extremely gentle and modest and shy. He had حياء, as Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said. Al-haya, modesty and bashfulness, is goodness in its entirety. And he also said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-haya, modesty and bashfulness, is of al-iman, meaning an important part of iman. And when he went to one of his shaykhs, Muhammad ibn Salam, and he went as a student to him and spoke to him, discussed, and later left, Muhammad ibn Salam afterwards commented to his students and asked, do you think that even a virgin could have more haya and modesty and bashfulness than this person? And indeed he was referring to the bashfulness and the shyness and modesty of Imam al-Bukhari.
وقال الحسين بن محمد السمرقندي أحد العلماء رحمه الله: كان محمد بن إسماعيل البخاري مخصوصا بثلاث خصال مع ما كان فيه من الخصال الحميدة: كان قليل الكلام، وكان لا يطمع فيما عند الناس، وكان لا يشتغل بأمور الناس، كل شغله كان في العلم.
And Hussein ibn Muhammad al-Samarqandi, a scholar, said about him that he was known, Imam al-Bukhari that is, for three great characteristics. Firstly, he used to speak very little. And secondly, he had no ambitions and hopes for the possessions of other people. And thirdly, he wouldn't be concerned with the gossip and the speech which revolved around people as well.
والأمثلة على ذلك كثيرة ولا ولعلي يعني أختصر فأذكر فقط يعني من لطفه وأدبه ورفقه بأصحابه ومن ورحمته بمن تحت يده أنه جاءته مرة جاريته وهي العبدة المملوكة فلما دخلت المنزل عثرت على محبرة بين يدي البخاري رحمه الله فقال لها كيف تمشين يعني من باب الغضب عليها كيف تمشين قالت إذا لم يكن طريق فكيف أمشي عند ذلك شعر الإمام البخاري أنه قد اشتد عليها وأنه قد يكون لها وجه عذر فبسط يديه وقال لها اذهبي فقد عتقتك فلامه جلساؤه في ذلك فقال إن كانت أغضبتني فإني أرضيت نفسي بما فعلت فإني أرضيت نفسي بما فعلت وهذا من المجاهدة الشديدة للنفس
And of the examples of his gentleness, his softness, is he had a slave girl and she came in, but there was an inkwell that had been misplaced and put in the wrong place. And he got angry, Imam Bukhari, asking, how do you deal in the streets? How do you conduct yourself? Meaning you can't even put this thing away. And she said, I conduct myself as a person should conduct themselves. He realized that he had been harsh. He realized he'd been severe. So he touched her hand and humbled himself and said, I freed you for the sake of Allah.
SubhanAllah.
And then she said, the people around him said, you've angered. The people around him said, this person has angered you. This slave girl has angered you. How can you just free her? Then Imam al-Bukhari said, in the way she angered me, I have now pleased myself with her error for the sake of Allah.
نعم. وكان رحمه الله يقول ما اغتبت أحدا قط بعد أن علمت أن الغيبة حرام.
And of his examples of his scrupulousness in speech is that I haven't written a hadith or I haven't ما اغتبت
أحدا بعدما علمت منذ أن علمت أن الغيبة حرام.
And he said, I have never backbited anyone since I realized or knew that backbiting is haram.
وهذا هذا الجانب هذه الأخلاق الطيبة هذه النفس الطيبة ظهر أثرها على علمه وفي علمه وفي ألفاظه وفي كتبه ولهذا قال ابن حجر رحمه الله للبخاري في كلامه على الرجال توق زائد وتحر بليغ يظهر لمن تأمل كلامه في الجرح والتعديل فإن أكثر ما يقول سكتوا عنه فيه نظر تركوه ونحو ذلك يعني هذا أشد ما يقوله من الكلام إذا أراد أن يجرح شخصا يقول سكتوا عنه فيه نظر تركوه ولا يتجاوز هذا الحد.
And a lot of the things that show how good and pure his heart was towards other people. And because of it, the goodness of his heart and not wanting to backbite, we see the effect of that in his books and his knowledge. Ibn Hajar, who wrote about al-Bukhari, said, Whoever reflects on the words of al-Bukhari, which he chooses to criticize narrators and really thinks about it, they'll find that he was of the people of the utmost caution when criticizing. About a narrator who he's rejecting and criticizing, the most he would say is, people were silent about him, or they abandoned his hadith, rather than going deeper.
فهذا هو ثمرة العلم والتقوى والصلاح واتباع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في أخلاقه وأدابه، أن يظهر ذلك على لسان العالم وعلى سلوكه فيكون نموذجا صالحا في حسن الخلق ولطف العبارة وفي الإحسان للقريب والبعيد وللصديق والعدو.
So this is the fruit of knowledge, the fruit of taqwa, the fruit of righteousness, and the fruit of following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one's conduct and behavior, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests all this in their behavior, and the person becomes an example for the near and the far of good behavior, gentleness in speech, and correctness in that.
ثم المجموعة الثالثة من الأسباب التي اجتمعت لهذه الشخصية الفذة، أسباب اجتمعت لتكوين هذه الشخصية العظيمة، فقد ذكرنا الأسباب المواهب التي وهبها الله سبحانه وتعالى لهذا الإنسان، ثم ذكرنا ما اتصف به من جهاد النفس ومن الإخلاص ومن الحرص على العلم ومن حسن الأخلاق، ثم بعد ذلك سبب آخر من أسباب الصلاح، البيئة الصالحة.
We've now come to the third reason or third of the characteristics or factors which made him a unique imam. We've mentioned previously the natural gifts given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and secondly, the struggle he had, his own earnings of struggling with his nafs and his good morals and manners and behavior. And now we're moving on to the goodness of the environment he lived in.
وأول شيء في هذه البيئة الأسرة، فالبيت هو المحضن الأول الذي يتربى فيه الإنسان ويتلقى المبادئ والأخلاق. كان والد الإمام البخاري رحمه الله كان رجلا صالحا، وذكروا عنه أنه قال عند مماته، قال: ليس في مالي درهم من حرام ولا درهم من شبهة.
So of the factors which are within the category of environment, first of all, is his family. The family within which he is raised and he receives his principles for life and morals. His dad was a righteous person, his father. It is recorded that before his father died, that his father said, in my wealth there is not a single gold or silver coin of which is haram nor doubtful.
ومات أبوه وهو صغير فتربى في حجر أمه وكانت أيضا امرأة صالحة عابدة وفي ذلك قصة من القصص الدالة على أثر الصلاح في حياة أهله.
But his father was, Imam al-Bukhari was young when his father died. And it was his mother who, after that, who took, upheld the responsibility on her own of looking after him. And she was known to be a person who was righteous and a worshipper of Allah. And this, here's a story which shows this righteousness and its effect.
فقد كان الإمام البخاري رحمه الله قد أصيب في بصره وهو صغير، فقد بصره وهو صغير، فأكثرت أمه من الدعاء، فرأت في المنام الخليل إبراهيم عليه الصلاة والسلام، فقال لها: يا هذه، قد رد الله على ابنك بصره بكثرة دعائك، بكثرة دعائك فأصبح وقد رد الله عز وجل عليه بصره.
And the story is that Imam al-Bukhari, when he was young, he lost his eyesight. His mother made so much dua, so profusely, that she saw in a dream that Ibrahim alayhi salam said, "Oh," referring to the mother, "Allah has given your son his vision back to him because of his profuse and ample supplication. In the morning when she went to her son, he was able to see again and his vision had been restored."
حتى أنه بعد ذلك كان يجلس في المسجد النبوي ويكتب الحديث على ضوء القمر.
He even used to sit in the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's masjid and he would be writing hadith under the light or under the light of the moon.
وقد حجت أمه به وبأخيه فقام البخاري في الحجاز ورجعت هي إلى بلادها وأقام هو في طلب الحديث واستمر في ذلك.
And his mother took him and his brother to Hajj. His mother returned, but Imam al-Bukhari remained to study knowledge and to continue in the study of hadith.
والمقصود أثر صلاح الوالدين في صلاح الأولاد في صلاح الذرية ونشأتهم نشأة صالحا. فأنت أخي المسلم وأختي المسلمة إذا أردت وإذا أردت أن يصلح الله سبحانه وتعالى ذريتكم ويكون منكم العلماء والصلحاء لابد أن تكونوا قدوة صالحة في البيت وتتحرون الحلال في المأكل والمشرب والمسكن وتكثرون الدعاء واللجوء إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى في إصلاح الذرية.
So we can see from this the effect of good parenting and the righteousness of one's parents in one's own lives. So, O brother, O sister, if you wish to find rectification for your children, and you want that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises from your children scholars and that those who will correct righteously, then be a righteous model for the children, for the people in your house. Make sure you're a person who is cautious about not entertaining the haram and only being within the halal in your food and drink in your homes, and also be a person who does dua to Allah frequently and in abundance for the rectification and the guidance of your offspring.
ثم البيئة العامة المجتمع الإسلامي في ذاك الوقت في ذاك الصدر الأول كان مليئا بالعلماء والمحدثين والصالحين سواء في بلده الأصلي في بخارى أم في سائر أرجاء العالم الإسلامي الذي تجول فيه أثناء رحلاته الكثيرة لطلب العلم فلقي كثيرا من أئمة الفقه والحديث وكذلك كانوا أئمة في الزهد والتقوى والصلاح فتأثر بهم غاية التأثر وتأدب بآدابهم واقتبس من علومهم وحرص على أن يسير على نهجهم وطريقتهم.
But it was at that time that the environment around him, the world at that time, the Islamic world, was full of ulama, scholars, and the righteous. So Imam al-Bukhari, whether in his original home territory and town, or in the world around him where he traveled, he would meet righteous scholars. He would meet leaders and imams of fiqh, of hadith. He would meet people who were imams of guidance when it came to renouncing the dunya, imams of guidance when it came to taqwa and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being cautious and scrupulous. And from him he took his knowledge. From them he took his knowledge. Until from them he took ilm and his way of life.
ومشايخه أولئك العلماء الأجلاء لما وجدوا فيه معالم الذكاء والحرص والصلاح والاستقامة شجعوه وحرصوا عليه واستوصوا به. وكان الإمام أحمد في بغداد يقول له لما يأتي الإمام البخاري إلى بغداد زائرا لطلب الحديث ثم يرجع، فيقول له الإمام أحمد: تترك بغداد وفيها العلماء وفيها الناس وتذهب إلى خراسان، يعني تذهب إلى بلاد بعيدة، وأنت أهل أن تبقى هنا بين العلماء لتستفيد؟ فيحرص الإمام البخاري على هذا الإنسان أن يبقى في بغداد حتى يستفيد من ذاك الجو العلمي.
And his sheikhs, his teachers, when they saw his intellect, his qualities, and his ambition, they encouraged him. He would receive encouragement from those around him. So much so that in Baghdad, when Imam al-Bukhari visited there for a period of time, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal asked him, "Are you actually about to leave Baghdad and go back to Khorasan?" To encourage him to stay in Baghdad, to benefit from the knowledge which there, and to, with the qualities and potentials he had, to allow those potentials and knowledge to grow there. So he received such encouragement from them.
طيب الوقت داهمنا، فطبعا الكلام كثير ولا ندري ماذا نفعل يعني حقيقة، لكن هذا كله، كل ما تقدم وعرضته بالتسلسل، هذا كله اجتمع لصنع هذه الشخصية حتى يكون عالما، حتى يكون فقيها، حتى يكون حافظا ومحدثا. فاستحق الثناء من شيوخه، الثناء العظيم. مرة يقولون عليه يعني سيد، يقولون عنه سيد الفقهاء، ويقدمونه مشايخه، يقدمونه ويسألون منه ويرجعون إليه، والنصوص في ذلك كثيرة جدا، ليس هناك وقت الحقيقة أن نذكر شيئا منها.
So I don't know what to do because there's so much to mention and time is short. So that's Imam al-Bukhari. He was a person who became a scholar, a muhaddith, an example of good behavior and conduct and knowledge and practice, that he was praised by his scholars and his contemporaries. For example, there are many, but one example is they would call him the master of the jurists, Sayyid al-Fuqaha, and they would, his teachers would have him referred to for issues they were asked about, so he became the reference point.
نعم. إذن الإمام البخاري بعدما تأهل وأثنى عليه مشايخه وقدموه، صار أهلا لأن يؤلف ويصنف، فكتب كتبه المشهورة وأشهرها على الإطلاق كتاب الجامع الصحيح، ثم التاريخ الكبير والأدب المفرد وغير ذلك من الكتب المشهورة. لكن لعلنا نذكر كلمة مختصرة عن صحيح الإمام البخاري، فلعلنا نختم بذلك.
And yes, so he was praised by his sheikhs, and he was encouraged and inspired to write, and he has many books like the Sahih, his book of Hadith. He also has the Great History book, and he has the Adab al-Mufrad. And perhaps we'll conclude this majlis with some words about his book al-Sahih.
الإمام البخاري رحمه الله سمع الإمام إسحاق بن راهويه يقول لأصحابه من أهل الحديث: لو جمعتم كتابا مختصرا لسنن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. فوقع ذلك في قلب البخاري، قال: فأخذت في جمع الكتاب.
So Imam al-Bukhari was in a gathering of his Shaykh Ishaq ibn Rahawayh, who was saying to his students, if only someone would compile a book which is completely authentic in hadith. He said that idea entered his heart, and when it did and it penetrated, he started after that to want to, and he did write his book, the Sahih.
لما صنف الإمام البخاري كتاب الصحيح كما قال أبو جعفر العقيلي عرضه على أئمة الحديث في زمانه، على علي بن المديني، على الإمام أحمد بن حنبل، على يحيى بن معين وغيرهم من أئمة هذا الشأن، فاستحسنوه وشهدوا له بالصحة إلا 4 أحاديث قال العقيلي القول فيها قول البخاري وهي صحيحة.
So Abu Ja'far al-Uqayli said about al-Bukhari that when he did compile his book, he presented it to senior ulama of hadith in his time, like Ali ibn al-Madini, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and Yahya ibn Ma'in. And he said, al-Uqayli said, they accepted all his book, except there were 4 hadith which were discussed with some criticism. However, al-Uqayli said, the truth and the proof is stronger on the side of al-Bukhari.
والإمام البخاري عفوا الإمام البخاري رأى أن يجعل في صحيحه مذهبه واختياره مذهبه الفقهي، بل أن يركز على بيان المعتقد الصحيح من خلال ترتيب الكتاب ومن خلال شحنه بالآثار عن الصحابة ومن بعدهم، حتى يبرز من خلال ذلك عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة.
And Bukhari wanted to show his understandings of the hadith and his school of thought, his own school of deriving rulings. And that's what we see in the way he organized his books with chapter headings and with narrations from the companions. And from that, we can derive from these narrations, from the way he organized his books and the quotations he makes, his belief and aqidah.
ورتب صحيحه ترتيبا يدل على ذكاء وفطنة وحسن اختيار، كما يقال اليوم، يعني يستعملون إذا أرادوا أن يمدحوا حسن التصرف في شخص في تأليف كتاب أو كذا، يقولون فلسفة فلان في هذا الأمر، وأنا لا أحب استعمال هذه الكلمة، ولكن يقول ذكاؤه وفطنته وحسن اختياره في ترتيب هذا الكتاب.
So the aqidah of Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah would be derived from that. So his, in the way he organized his book, his intellect, the way he chose hadith for certain for the chapter headings, it would show how clever he was. Today people say a statement which I don't particularly like to use, the philosophy of so-and-so in organizing his book. I'd like to say the deep and outstanding intellect of Imam al-Bukhari in organizing his book.
وأبين لكم هذا باختصار حتى تحفظوه ويكون في ذاكرتكم إن شاء الله تعالى. الإمام البخاري بدأ كتابه ب 3 كتب مهمة متدرجة، فأول ما بدأ بكتاب بدء الوحي، كتاب كيف كان بدء الوحي.
So being brief, I'll mention something which I hope you can memorize about the organization of his books, of his book. He began his book As-Sahih with 3 chapters. The first being the beginning. How did revelation begin? How did revelation begin?
كأنه أراد أن يقول لنا بذلك أن هذا الأمر وهذا الدين إنما مبدأه وأصله من الوحي، فلا يؤخذ إلا عن الوحي.
As if he wants to say to us that this religion, this way of life, its origin is revelation, and therefore we don't take our deen and religion except from revelation.
فلما جاء الوحي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وكلف بالتبليغ والبيان، ماذا وجب على الناس؟ وجب على الناس الإيمان به، فجعل الكتاب الثاني في صحيحه كتاب الإيمان. لأن بعد مجيء الوحي لا بد من الإقرار والإذعان.
So after the revelation comes to people, the revelation or the knowledge, the hadith that comes to people, what is their duty towards that knowledge? Their duty is to have iman and belief in that, which is why the next chapter after that is the chapter or the book of iman, because a person after receiving knowledge has to submit themselves to knowledge and be humble to it and believe in it.
إذن لما عرفنا الوحي وعرفنا الإيمان وأقررنا وأذعنا وعرفنا يعني حقيقة هذا الإيمان، لكن نحتاج إلى العمل به، إلى العمل بما يقتضيه، وإلى العمل بما هو داخل في مسماه من أحكام الشريعة، وذلك لا يكون إلا بالعلم، بطلب العلم ومعرفة آداب طلب العلم ومعرفة أهمية ذلك. فجعل الكتاب الثالث كتاب العلم.
And after a person has had iman in the wahi, the revelation that's been revealed, has submitted to it, has affirmed it in their heart, now a person is in need of practicing and actions which are details of the iman he has. Now he needs knowledge to practice that iman, which is why the next chapter, the third book after that, is the book of ilm, the book of knowledge, and it talks about the etiquettes of seeking knowledge, the importance of knowledge, and its significance.
ثم بعد ذلك ذكر ما يتعلق بأحكام الشريعة من أحكام الصلاة والصوم والزكاة والحج وما إلى ذلك من أحكام النكاح والمعاملات، وكذلك السيرة والتفسير، إلى أن ساق الكتب هذه، ساق الكتب وأبوابها، ساقها كلها.
And then after those three chapters, he wrote in detail the hadith and narrations and knowledge about worship and how to do that, about dealings as well, for example, marriage, and seerah and lives, or life of the Prophet and prophets.
نعم، ختم بعد ذلك ختم صحيحه بثلاثة كتب، كما بدأها بثلاثة كتب هي مدخل لصحيحه، فلا بد أن يختمها بثلاثة كتب أيضا فيه مقصد وذكاء.
After mentioning all those chapters about worship and trade and dealings and lives of people and their seerah, as he began the book with three important books or chapters which spoke about his objectives, it's only relevant and that he would seal his book and conclude his book with three important chapters too.
فذكر كتاب أخبار الآحاد، وأراد بذلك أن يرد على الذين يشوشون على السنة النبوية بدعوى أن ما ذكره البخاري في صحيحه أو ما ذكره غيره من العلماء من أخبار الآحاد التي لا تلزمنا، فذكر الأدلة في هذا الكتاب على الاحتجاج بخبر الآحاد.
So of the three books which he concludes his book with is the book of accepting the narrations and hadith which are ahad, singular paths. In it he's refuting people who would want to refute him and say that his book is of no value because a lot of the narrations are ahad and not of not mutawatir. In this hadith, by doing that he gives evidence of why accepting the ahad is important and part of our deen.
ثم بعد ذلك ذكر كتاب الاعتصام بالكتاب والسنة، لأن من يعني كان معه في هذه المراحل من العلم الذي هذه المراحل التي بدأت ببدء الوحي ثم الإيمان والعلم ثم أحكام الشريعة، يحتاج إلى أن يكون له أساس ثابت حتى يثبت على ما دلت عليه هذه الأحاديث والآثار من أحكام، فلا يخرج عنها إلى البدعة وإلى الرأي وإلى الاستخفاف بحديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فهذا الكتاب كتاب الاعتصام بالكتاب والسنة، كأنه قدمه في آخر كتابه ليكون عاملا على التثبيت على السنة وعلى الأخذ بما تقدم من العلم في الكتاب، الأخذ به بقوة وثبات وثقة.
And the penultimate book in his Bukhari is the book of holding fast al-i'tisam with the book and the sunnah. The previous stages of the book itself, the previous stages of the whole book in its entirety, speak about knowledge and practices of religions. Then he wanted to take all those previous laws and regulations to an important foundation, the foundation of holding fast to the knowledge that has preceded. So the person after all this knowledge doesn't get diverted into bid'ah and innovation. That a person after this knowledge has come to them wouldn't get diverted to following a person's opinion rather than the knowledge in the hadith, or belittling hadith. So he wants to put it all into context of that all the knowledge that has preceded, a person is to have firmness in what the practice of the sunnah, and that he's to apply it with certainty and trust and conviction.
ثم ختم كتابه العظيم هذا بكتاب التوحيد، وهو آخر كتاب في صحيحه كتاب التوحيد، ليختم كتابه بالرد على الذين انحرفوا عن توحيد الله سبحانه أو في توحيد الله سبحانه وتعالى، انحرفوا في ذلك بآرائهم وعقولهم فخرجوا إلى التأويل والتعطيل. فبدأ هذا الكتاب أولا بتقرير توحيد الألوهية، فذكر حديث معاذ لما بعثه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى اليمن فقال: إنك تأتي قوما أهل كتاب، فليكن أول ما تدعوهم إليه شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله. وذكر أيضا حديث معاذ رضي الله عنه لما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم له: أتدري ما حق العباد على الله وما ما حق الله على العباد وما حق العباد على الله.
And the final book which he concludes the book with is the book of Tawheed, a refutation on the deviant groups and deviant ideas about Tawheed, those who challenge Tawheed with their opinions and their whims, and they approach and enter into the bad and the wrong avenues of nullifying Allah's names and attributes or distorting them in their meanings. He quotes firstly the hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, that when he was sent to Yemen, he was told by the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that you will indeed encounter the people of the book, so let the first thing you call them to be the witnessing that there is no one worthy of worship except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he mentioned after that the hadith of Mu'adh, which is where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asks, "O Mu'adh, do you know what the rights of Allah upon his slaves are? And do you know what the rights of Allah's slaves upon him are if they do that?" To the end of the hadith.
نعم ثم قرر توحيد الأسماء والصفات وأفرد الرد على الجهمية وأهل التعطيل والتأويل لصفات الله سبحانه وتعالى، ليكون المسلم محصرا من تلك الانحرافات، عقيدته على عقيدة الكتاب والسنة كما فهمها سلف الأمة.
And then he had a discourse using hadith about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and attributes and affirming them fully, and that was a refutation against the Jahmiyyah, the Jahmites, who did ta'atil and nullified Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and attributes, so that a person would be by following his hadith protected from deviation and have the aqeedah of the book and the sunnah upon the understanding of the salaf of this ummah.
فهذه كلمة يسيرة قصيرة عن الإمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى وعن صحيحه، ولا شك أن محاضرة ولا محاضرات كثيرة لا تقدر أن توفي هذا الإمام حقه، ولا يخفى عليكم أن هناك عشرات الكتب والدراسات والبحوث عن حياة الإمام البخاري رحمه الله وعن صحيحه، وإنما أردنا فقط ذكر جانب يسير من الجوانب التي قد تكون مفيدة في التعرف على شخصية الإمام البخاري.
So these are just a few words about the life of this Imam and his book, especially his book, the Sahih. And as you know, one lecture or even tens of lectures can't do justice to the works of this person. And you will also know that there are books and studies on Imam al-Bukhari. There are many of them, but what I have mentioned are some of the aspects of that of his life and his work, al-Bukhari al-Sahih, which will be of benefit for us here.
وأختم بما ختم الإمام البخاري صحيحه، فذكر حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه، قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: كلمتان خفيفتان على اللسان، ثقيلتان في الميزان، سبحان الله وبحمده، سبحان الله العظيم.
And I shall end my speech with that which Imam al-Bukhari concluded and ended his book with, the hadith of Abu Huraira, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there are two sentences, they are so light on the tongue, yet so heavy on the scales. They are, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, glory be to Allah and all praise to him, wa subhanallah al-azim, and glory be to Allah, the most magnificent.
جزاكم الله خير على صبركم واستماعكم وحسن حضوركم، بارك الله فيكم.
غرباء غرباء.